Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to season two of Conversations in Pop Culture. And before I introduce my guest, I do want to remind everybody that links are up above for the Kickstarter as well as my new shirt. It is a Gundam shirt, and you can buy me a coffee, which is the greatest way how to support this Kickstarter. And I'm just going to quickly show you my new shirt just like that, so you can pick that up. And without further ado, my guest today is Rodney Fyke. Hopefully I got your name correct.
Yes, you got it.
Welcome. So welcome to the show, because I'm excited.
Thank you. Thank you. Me too. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, I am excited. Obviously, somebody emailed me. Tina emailed me on Facebook or messaged me, and then we sort of set this up. And obviously, you have a Kickstarter currently going on called Pitter Patter Issue 1 and 2. And so I think the best place to start here is, what is the basic story and the basic premise of this comic?
The basic premise is it's a book about two house cats from different sides of the track. So, and we throw them in all kinds of situations, and they have differing opinions because they both come from different sides of the track. So it's heavily, very heavily influenced by Looney Tunes, which I grew up on, and they kind of play off each other like a Abbott and Costello or a Martin and Lewis. So, you know, the straight man, funny man. But yeah, so that's the premise. The first issue centers around Dude, who is the gray cat right behind me. He brings home a new, he's not the sharpest knife in the drawer. He brings home a new friend, Dizzy the Spinner Mouse, and wants basically Buddy's permission to introduce him, bring him into the house. And Buddy's trying to figure out a tactful way of letting him know that it's just a toy. So they go back and forth, and it's just, you know, comedy quip after comedy quip. And, eventually they decide on whether Dizzy can stay. So that's issue one. And in issue two, we, address the issue of whether or not it's, the grass is greener on the other side for cats to be an inside cat or an outside cat. So,
and then let's talk a little bit about that, because,
okay.
There's a lot of stuff going on with this. And in particular, we have, I think, where Dude is a happy-go-lucky sheltered kitten, and Buddy is a street cat, and he's sort of a no-nonsense, rough-and-tumble type cat. And so, obviously, they are coming from different worlds, different lives. You know, they obviously, one of them has had a lot more, I guess, privilege and a lot safer environment and a lot more cuddle love. And one of them is definitely rough and tougher. So when we talk about them, they are very interesting when they're put together inside the same house.
Yes.
And with the same owner. And obviously, they're sort of the odd couple in a lot of ways.
Exactly. Yeah. Which is a recipe for hilarity.
Oh, it's great. And I don't know how many people have seen The Odd Couple, that show, but it's brilliant with Felix and Oscar. But what was this like building this out? Because it's very cool when you have two house cats coming from different worlds, completely, you know, opposite sides of the track, and now they're in an environment, and well, they have to coexist. They're both loved, so no cats being abused. I want to make that crystal clear.
Oh no, and the thing is they're despite their differing, I don't want to say opinions, but their differing outlooks on things. They're best friends. Buddy is always looking out for Dude, and Dude would give the shirt off of his back to help protect Buddy. So, yeah, there's that mutual admiration society going on there. But we play them off of each other. And as far as building the world, it's just tons of fun. My biggest problem is every time I sit down to write a story, I keep coming up with new characters.
But that's a good problem, because obviously this is very much more geared as being a wholesome PG book versus going down the rabbit hole of I can't think of another book that's darker. You know, I just had Ruben Romero, and The Illusion Witch is a good example. That's more of an adult book by nature. And this is meant for everybody, where I feel very comfortable giving a 5-year-old this book and giving a 50-year-old this book at the same time.
Yeah, and that's intentional, because once again, it's based, you know, so heavily influenced by Looney Tunes. And, you know, when I was a kid, and all of my peers were kids, we were laying on the living room floor watching Looney Tunes, laughing our asses off. And the adults behind us were standing there in the kitchen looking in, and they were laughing too because they were getting the adult humor and we were getting the kid humor. So that's what I've tried to create here. I don't want to say it's blue. It's not blue. We don't really have foul language, but it's ornery in a fun way.
Yeah, so, and that's something that I really like about this is that it could be read at multiple levels. Yeah. And the idea that you could read it very much as a slice of life. You could read it just for what it is. You could read it, you know, at a kid's level, and you could read it from a cat's perspective, which I think you do very well, where this is sort of like, hey, you know, obviously one of them brings home a toy / a new friend, and the other has never met a stranger before. Right. And it sounds crazy when you think about it, but it's the idea of when was the first time any of us met a stranger, and then that stranger is maybe not real, or maybe it is real, maybe it has other intentions, maybe, you know, and how do you react? And we're seeing how a cat reacts to it. And I don't know, obviously, I think you have kittens and you have cats. I used to have a cat, and well, I have a dog now, and she gets puzzled around people sometimes.
Yeah.
And so obviously this is very cool to get that sense of it, because you could view it very adult, or you could view the entire thing as being ridiculously funny, which it also is. And
right.
So that, like, building that up, it's super, super interesting.
Yeah, and the other thing that I like to do too is I like to write poignant moments, because dude is very naive, but he's very genuine. He's very heartfelt. At the beginning of issue two, he asks, you know, where do they all go? He's talking about the butterflies and stuff. Where do they all go at night? And he's genuinely interested, you know, where do they all go? And he thinks, you know, they go off and everything's happy-go-lucky, and they get up in the morning and grab the lunchbox and go off to work. You know, he doesn't know that, you know, out there, everybody's, it's all about survival, because you're food to somebody. So it's that naivete, you know, that I lace in there that just makes him that much more endearing.
Yeah, and it's also really nice just to have an innocent character in a comic. I hate to say this, and this is going to sound so messed up, but it's very nice to have a wholesome, naive character, because I read a lot of books that are dark. I read a lot of books that have direct conflict. I'm in the middle of a book right now where there's a war going on and nobody's innocent. Right. And, you know, I think dude is very, very naive, and he's very, you know, not wondering what's going on in the world. And then we have his counterpart who's sort of educating him a lot. And that's kind of what book two deals with, is that we're learning how Buddy came in to live with, you know, BDL, who's their owner, and who's lovable. And I love how you named it Big D. And so obviously, I don't know, this might be based on a true story. What do I know? But but even still, like, I love the fact that we get that backstory in issue two, because issue one is a little bit shorter and it's sort of just a story, and then we get the backstory with that.
Not anymore. We actually, since we hit our first stretch goal, which was 1500, we're now at 1658, I believe. We're going to add a 5-page short story in the back of issue one, which introduces other characters in their universe. So,
and so obviously, even to talk about that, and we'll get back to BDL. Well, what is that like? Because obviously, you know, you started issue one before, and then I think either that was kickstarted or it was self-published. I'm not exactly sure, but obviously, your first story sometimes has to be shorter just because it reduces costs. You want to test the market. And then say, we realize that it's shorter, and so we're going to be adding to it, and we're going to be adding a backup story, because we don't want to break continuality, I guess.
Yeah.
Continuum,
yeah.
But we also don't want to deprive our audience of giving them just 16 pages, for instance, or giving them 18 pages. We want to be closer to that 24 mark. So what was that like, figuring that out? Because it is important, you know, to have some form of consistency.
Yeah, the initial intent with Pitter Patter was to do 12 or 16 page books, because they were easier to produce, quicker, and we could get more books on the shelf. So it was kind of a companion book for us to bundle in with our peanut pudding and jelly book, just to kind of sweeten the pot a little bit. And then as we went on, and the characters just kept talking to me, and the universe kept expanding, we talked about it. It's like, well, this is a pretty viable thing, and cats are so popular. Everybody loves cats, and I'm like, let's just make this a thing.
Including Mark Cuban, guys. He loves cats. I don't know if you've seen, I want to draw a cat for you on Shark Tank.
No.
Oh, it's the greatest thing ever. This guy came up with this ridiculous concept where he teamed up with Groupon, essentially, and he draws cats for people for like $25 in credit. Okay. And with background, then it's crazy. Came on Shark Tank. Mark Cuban offers him like $25,000 for one third of the business. And like the thing exploded. And I think they did like $400,000 or $500,000.
Wow.
and Mark Cuban's like drawing people's cats for like 2 or 3 years, one out of every 1,000, you get a Mark Cuban cat. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And it's ridiculous.
Wow. That's cool. I'm going to figure out how to do something like that.
And so, but continue about how this was built out, because total aside.
Yeah. So we wanted it to be more than just something to bundle with peanut pudding and jelly. So we at that point, we decided, well, we're going to make it its own thing. And obviously, the first issue's shorter. So I wrote a backup story. And gave it to an artist to produce, and then COVID hit, and it kind of put it on the back burner, and that situation never panned out for whatever reason. So we figured, well, we're gonna expand it, but I'm gonna go ahead with issue two. We're gonna expand issue one somehow, but it'll present itself when it presents itself. So we were in the larva stage of putting together the Kickstarter for. Because we never did a Kickstarter for issue one. We just self-published it. So we decided we were going to do a Kickstarter for issues one and two. And one of the stretch goals was going to be, if we get to X amount of dollars, that our buddy Sean Forney was going to do the backup story in it, which, you know, it was already there. It was already written. It was already thumbnailed out and everything. So he just basically had to go knock it out real quick. So he's going to finish pencils on that, and I'm going to ink it and color it. And we're going to add that to the back of issue one with a couple, you know, we're probably going to put some pinups in there that we've gotten from people over the last year or so and stuff like that. So it'll be a nice hefty book.
and to even go into that a little bit further, because obviously this sort of started out as a companion book, because you have other books out there, and obviously you're hitting a particular demographic, which is definitely all ages, and all age comics are complicated, and obviously having a lot of material and having something that's sort of a companion book to get more books on the shelf. And obviously, because if you get, you know, a parent hooked on one and you get the kid hooked on one of your titles, they wind up funneling all the way in.
Right.
And that's typically how kids' books work in a lot of ways. And so obviously this started out, and then what was it like saying, wait a second, we have something that is super popular and this is not a companion book anymore. This has to be equal to the rest and not be just a companion, but be another title in our company and be another, you know, thing to choose from and not be that sort of companion where the hold in between type book. This is its own thing now, because it's very cool when that happens.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and it was completely organic too, because at that point we had already done 6 issues of Peanut Pudding and Jelly. And it was becoming a harder and harder sell, because kids' books, as good as they can be, if they haven't hit yet, they're kind of hard to market. And then we had a 7th issue, but it's still on the shelf. It never saw the light of day because we moved on. We do a horror book called Roadkill Rampage as well, and we did a book called Unchained, which is also an adult themed kind of drama suspense book. And then I picked up some other work from some other companies and stuff, but the pitter patter just keeps growing. Every time I sit down to do, I just did a 2 character designs today. This is for the backup story for issue 3, who Nate Lovett, I don't know if you're familiar with Nate Lovett or not, but he's going to be drawing the backup story for issue 3. So we will be handing all of those character designs off to him at the Gem City Comic Con this coming weekend, and the script and the character designs. And I will be finishing up the script for issue three and start drawing issue three.
And for those who don't know, obviously you are the main artist.
Yes.
On this. Yeah, I think
I created it, draw it, color it, ink it. Only thing I don't do is letter it.
Because lettering is an art, and the lettering can screw up a comic. You pick the wrong font. Oh my God, it can screw up a comic.
Oh, yeah.
God knows how. So
we have.
I
was going to say we have a phenomenal letterer. He's a letterer and graphic designer. His name is Dave Lentz, L-E-N-T-Z.
All over the place.
All over the place.
Worked on Ruben's book.
Yes. He's basically Source Point Press's letterer, and just a great guy. Just love his stuff, and he'll. Like he was sending me the pages for issue two, you know, a couple at a time and for approval. And I would go over and I was like, okay, this is cool. This is there. And this is, and he even, you know, he even suggested a couple of lines that, what do you think? This is a suggestion. You can tell me no or tell me yes. And a couple instances, I'm like, okay, I like that better. That works better. So he's not just your, you know, he doesn't just have his blinders on and he's going to letter your book. He's paying attention to the content. And he is willing to offer critiques and suggestions to make the books better. And that is priceless. And he's phenomenally talented and he does all of our graphic designs for all of our trade dresses on all of our covers and stuff. And we're just happiest bunch with him.
And obviously, and then also, I mean, you write the scripts for the backup stories. And what is that like for you? Because obviously you're doing the main story, but then what is it like to hand off saying, hey, it's a backup story. And I get a backup story. And not beating anybody down here, but it's obviously not the main story. It's very important, and it can help make a book, but it's also handing off your baby, and there's a trust issue sometimes.
That's true, but I think, and again, this just happened completely organically. Last, maybe 2 weeks ago, we decided that the backup stories are going to be the other characters in the universe, which I will design all of the characters and the other artist will draw them in the backup story. So they're introduced by somebody else drawing them, which I'm fine with. But I love it because it just gives me an opportunity to get all these characters out of my head and into print. So I love it. It's great. And Sean did a great job. With the characters for issue that are going to be in issue one. And then I can't wait to see what Nate does with these characters that I've got here.
it's a fun book. And obviously I do think it is important to have, you know, your backup story be almost a world building tool in a lot of ways and help to introduce all these other characters, because obviously I don't know where the future is going with this, but at some point, you know, it's kind of nice when you have a backup story introducing a character. This way you don't have to, 4 issues down the road, if you want to continue to, you know, figure out a way how to introduce them because they were introduced in issue three. You know, and then also it's this idea that even when you compound these things and create, you know, a trade graphic novel, you know, you could have a whole backup section. And if you go long enough, because I know people who have done this, where they just have 4-panel comics and it's almost an anthology. You know, Dust Bunny Mafia does this very, very well, where that's all it is that it's just a bunch of comics that are 4 panels or 5 panels, and he creates these nice big, you know, trade dresses of it. And it's great, and it's not a backup story, but you can do that, you know, 30 issues down the road. You can create an entire back issue by itself, essentially. It's very cool. It allows for a lot of possibilities. And also allows for things to be told in this world that don't affect Dude and Buddy, but can later on. And so it's very
because
it opens up the world a lot.
Yeah, it definitely does that. And I use flashback too. There is a flashback story in issue two. And actually the backup story in issue three, it is a flashback story, but it's basically the origin story of this group of characters and what their motivations are and where they come from. And it sets up their dynamic with another character. So I'm doing is I'm placing these building blocks of this neighborhood, this street, that this house is on, and I've got a blueprint hanging on my wall over there in front of my desk. I've got the top floor designed. I've got the basement designed. I've got the upstairs designed. I've got the backyard. And now I'm starting to lay out the neighborhood and who lives where. There is a wiener dog that lives next door. We've already established this. And you'll see him in issue 2 kind of peeking out of a window in the background. So there's just a whole, when I tell you that there's a whole world out there, I'm not kidding.
And what's nice about you is that you're the writer, you're the creator, and you're also an artist. And yes. It's very helpful because I would imagine that when you're writing, you know what is possible to do in a book, what makes sense artistically and what doesn't. So I am not a comic writer at the moment. Obviously, I know how to write. I cannot draw for anything. You held a gun to my head, I would say, well, you know, I'm dead. So I can book a cover. I understand what works in a cover, what makes something pop, what makes somebody very excited for something, just because I've been collecting comics forever and I have ideas and throw things out, but I can't draw it. And so I would imagine it's very helpful for you knowing, saying, hey, I understand how a house works. I understand from an artist's perspective how something is supposed to be written to make it work, and you're almost reverse engineering it. So what is that like for you? Because it's a real advantage.
Sometimes it can be tedious because you are essentially, you're building your world building. And it's like with issue 2, I had to do this scene where they're walking down, they're going, transitioning from upstairs to going downstairs into the man cave. And they're walking down this flight of steps. And I did it one way, and then later I was reading an issue, a comic book, and somebody else kind of did that in a different way from a completely different perspective and angle. And I'm like, oh, man, that just works so much better. But it was already drawn. It was already inked. It was already colored. It's fuel for the next time. And I kind of challenged myself with issue 2 because – I went back and I looked at issue 1 and I'm like, okay, I could have done this differently. I could have made this a little more dynamic. And daggone it, issue 2 is going to be more, I'm going to change those camera angles a little more. I'm going to, you know, pull back more and just, so it's not just a series of headshots and just going to mix it up a lot more. And I'm very happy with the way it turned out.
Yeah, I could imagine that it could be very, very tedious. And at the same time, though, it's a real advantage because
it's keeping the, you know, the backgrounds consistent. This is the TV screen. These are the movie posters, and there's something specific in those movie poster frames on the wall. And then you got to make sure that shelf over there, depending on the angle of the next panel, is in there in the background. And then there's a bar with bar stools in the back end of it. And that was a pain in the butt because it was just legs and perspective and all kinds of stuff. So, yeah, I mean, you're having to reverse engineer all that stuff and figure out the best way to do it. And, you know, everything's from a cat's perspective. So it's a worm's eye view looking up at the human world. So it's that angle a lot.
Yeah, and obviously, this is kind of cool. And this is cool. What I like about the book is that it is from a cat's perspective, and it's not from a human perspective. And it's really nice. And obviously, this is all about their adventures and all these other creatures' adventures. And I don't want to push too much further into this because I do want to talk about the other side of Kickstarter. And then we'll talk about the third side, which is always the fun side also. Or a more fun side, I should say. And that's, but first I want to talk about the reward. So obviously there's digital stuff.
Okay.
For those who want a cheaper option, for those who read digital comics, for those who say, hey, you know, I just want to live internationally. So there's that. And then there's also the regular edition, which I think this is the regular edition that I just threw up there.
Yep.
Now, it's not as crisp as I would like it to be. I'm the first person to admit it. It's not as crisp as I would like it, but That's the regular edition, and then there's the bundle for issues 1 and 2.
Yes.
And so, obviously, what is that? I think you did those covers.
I'm sorry, you broke up a little bit. What was the question?
So, what was it like building those two covers out and really keeping it relatively cheap for 2 issues at $15?
The first issue is I was still kind of trying to get my bearings with the characters because I had created them. I started with the heads, issue 1 there on the left, and I drew 4 or 5 pages worth of heads to try to find those two characters. And when I finally found them, then I had to put bodies to them. If you compare issue 1 to issue 2, you see that issue 2, they're a lot more fluid, a lot more animated, because they've evolved in my head. And they've evolved with me drawing them. And if you look at the Charlie Brown from the 1950s versus Charlie Brown of the 1980s or 90s, it's not the same character. He looks completely different because Charles Schulz evolved as an artist over that 40-year span in drawing him. And it's true with any comic book artist, any comic strip artist, they just evolve. So, and I enjoy, you know, trying to make them cuter, trying to make them fluffier, and anything I can do to make that happen, I'm going to continue doing that because everybody just says how much they love how cute and cuddly they are, which is, I love to hear.
and then also to talk about another issue, because you have a bunch of variants, and this is going retro.
Oh,
obviously,
yeah.
This is referencing, I believe, Batman and Robin. And
yeah. Batman and Robin number 9 from 1942.
And so what was this like building this out? Because obviously this hit certain fans. Everybody might not know that it's Batman and Robin number 9, but they know it's Batman and Robin. Obviously you have cats. It's very, very funny in a lot of ways. And I mean, it's just a cool cover and it's going old school in a lot of ways. So what was this like? Because
it was
a demographic.
It was awesome to getting the legs right on Buddy, or I mean on Dude, the dressed there as Robin, and trying to decide what I wanted to do with the feet. Did I want to do the toes, or did I want to do the pointed Robin elf shoes feet that he had, that Robin has? So ultimately, we decided to go with the feet because they're cuter, and just, you know, wrapping those costumes around those figures and having it look good, and then trying to figure out the mask for Buddy. It was just so much fun. I had a blast doing that. But yeah, that's my variant cover.
And then there's a bunch more. There's obviously the House Cap by Sean Forney. There's Outside Cap by Nate Lovett. There's Store Cat, which is basically the retail package for stores. And then I think there's the ability to get an you doing commissions as well. And so there's that stuff. And then, so what was this like having, you know, obviously 2 more variants, also making it very affordable for stores to pick up issues as well, because, you know, obviously a lot of comic shops want to support indie, but, you know, they don't want to break the bank doing it.
Yeah. I think, The deciding factor is always, I always picture myself at a convention on the other side of the table as a consumer. Would I pay $20 for this variant cover? So when we pick the artists to do the covers, we want the artist to be the best artist we can get that we can afford. And, you know, I mean, I did one, which I think turned out really great. And then Sean, who's doing, you know, the backup story for issue 1, and then Nate's doing the backup story for issue 3, both top-notch, phenomenal professional artists in the industry. And, I mean, I would throw down a $20 bill for either one of those comics with those covers on them. So that's kind of how we gauge what we do. And the store cat, you know,
that's very important in a lot of ways, because I want to stop you, because obviously when I'm going at a comic con, you know, I have a set budget on how I go, and obviously I tend to be in the comic book investing side of things, buying books. You know, I just listed a very expensive book, and I'm going to be listing more on my eBay store. And, you know, and obviously I'm sort of cashing out now on some of this stuff. And, but also I'm big into Zenoscope, and I also have bought $20 variants. And so obviously to make me want to spend 20 bucks, the cover has to catch my eye. And yeah. I think it's important. When I go to a con, I have about $100 in what I call play around money, meaning that whatever variant catches my eye. And so as I'm walking through Artist Alley, or I'm walking through Vendor Alley with certain artists, you know, or certain companies, it's like your cover has to catch my eye at least 5 to 10 feet out.
Yep.
And it's very important. And half the time I'm picking up these covers, I don't know who any of these artists are. At least 5 years ago, I didn't. I now know a lot more artists where I can spot like an Ebass or a Sankumanaki from like 15 feet away.
Oh, yeah.
But at this point, there's plenty of artists that I don't know, and it has to make me stop. Because yes. I hate to say this, but if you got 20,000 people and I'm walking by and there's a lot of stuff going on, I need to be able to stop.
Yep.
And that's something I think is super important. So, and I feel like these covers, at least, you know the Sean one makes me stop for a few reasons. Because obviously it's cute. There's some stuff going on. Those cats may or may not be lucky. But obviously, I also find it very playful. At
yes.
the same time. And, you know, obviously the entire Nate Lovett is also very playful, but in a different way.
Yeah.
So yes. what is that like in when you're booking something? Because I'm in the process of sort of booking it, and I'm going to be going down this road in about 6 months, somewhere along the lines of booking a cover. So obviously I'm now getting into that thing too. I just booked my t-shirt, so I'm well aware of how all this works. I'm making people stop.
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing comics since 89, so, and I've been going to comic book conventions all over the country since 89.
Making people stops new, though. Like, variants yeah. are very new. In
yeah.
So it's not 89. This wasn't around in 89. I know that I'm 28.
Oh, yeah.
I'm 28. Oh, yeah. So stop me if I'm wrong at any point, please. I love to learn. So stop me if I'm wrong at any point.
Well, back then, what made people stop was you had your portfolio turned open and your original art would stop people in their tracks, or you had your book standing up on the table, not laying flat, because just like you said, from 15 feet away, if that book is laying flat on the table, you're not going to be able to see it. If it's standing up, or if it's on an easel, or if we have a blown up 11 by 17 version of that comic book on an easel, you're going to see that from 30 feet away. So it's the tricks like that, and the artwork has to kick ass. It has to be brightly colored, or it has to be, you know, if the subject matter calls for it, have a more muted palette. But the subject, the camera angle, the lighting, all of that stuff is very important. And artists are as different as a bag of mixed nuts. But that's the beautiful thing about it is, you know, the reason we hired Sean and we hired Nate is, you know, Nate does all of Nate's stuff is kid-friendly stuff, Nickelodeon and Marvel and Puppy Tales and all that stuff. He's done all of that. So he's right in the wheelhouse for Pitter Patter. And Sean and I just did a book called Power Ninja Tunes. And, you know, and I knew Sean could do the cartoony stuff. And I said, hey, we got this new character we want to introduce. This female character, you know, to kind of draw some of the 18 to 34 year olds in to check it out. So here's what we want. And I kind of gave him a real rough sketch of it, and he knocked it out of the park.
And so yeah, it's, and obviously, I mean, you're hitting a bunch of different demographics, because obviously the Sean thing definitely targets a much older audience, and Nate's stuff targets a much lighter audience. And then obviously there's just the regular covers, which are very friendly. And then you got the homage cover to Batman and Robin 9, which targets also a cool audience where people might, you know, stop and say, oh, this is cool. And so obviously you're covering a lot of bases, yeah. which I think is very important. And then obviously just want to mention this really quickly, that you could basically get, you know, the entire package, which is all this stuff as well, for about $75, all the comics / variants. And I think you're saving some money on that as well. And yeah. so obviously that's very cool too in that regard. So, you know, that's something to keep in mind as well, where, you know, it's just an all-inclusive package. And then even going further into this is that there's some stuff that's been unlocked. So here's a bunch of stretch goals that are out there. So obviously Scarlet Huntress, the PDF, which I think is going to be emailed to you, trading card on a backer, the yoga sticker. I think you already hit the backup story.
Yeah.
And then there's the window cling, obviously, which is sort of the butterfly, it looks like.
That's a squirrel.
That's a squirrel. Wow. I am so off base, and clearly I can't see it for shit.
It's a squirrel with angel's wings.
It looks like a butterfly, and I don't think I'm the first person to say that. So clearly, if you thought it was a butterfly, you should like this video to make me feel better. If you thought it was a squirrel with angel's wings, before you answered, you should give it a heart. And so on that note, and then obviously if 2,500 is reached, you should get a magnet. And magnets are the best thing. It's metal cards and magnets are the greatest rewards because metal cards are fun to look at and magnets are actually useful.
I love magnets.
I love magnets too. And if I had my own apartment, my refrigerator would be covered with them, but I don't. So they get taken down and put into a bag and then I get yelled at, but that's okay. And then on the flip side, there's also a bunch of add-ons, which are cool. Obviously, you know, pins, trading cards, more stickers. You could add any covers. You could add any variants. Obviously, I think there's a mini art print set that's also, you know, some add-ons, and there might be some other stuff as well that I might not have mentioned. But a lot of cool add-ons too, which is nice.
Yeah.
As well, because more options again, where maybe you have two kids and they like to fight, and maybe you got to buy, you know, two separate copies. So that you could be happy and have a pleasant dinner.
That's right.
I'm just saying. To play with. The first time I heard that, you know, it's there's a reason why sometimes you buy two Power Ranger masks for your kids.
Oh yeah.
You know, the car ride is much easier on the way home.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So obviously that's all of the rewards on that side and the stretch goals. But I do want to talk about another topic, and we're about to get controversial because shipping is complicated.
Okay.
Kickstarter. I run an eBay business. I charge $10.
Okay.
The reason why is that sometimes it's $9, sometimes it's $11. On a CGC graded book, I charge $15 to $18. On a Pop Funko, I charge $12.
Okay.
On average. The post office, for those who don't know, in the last year has gone through about three or four spikes in pricing.
Yep.
And I left the eBay business for 3 months, and I learned very quickly on my first day back that, oh, it's expensive, you know, where, you know, and I was listing at $7 and it went to $10. That's a big increase.
Okay.
And I know that you're charging money for shipping, and I don't think you're making any money from shipping. So what is this like for you trying to figure out what the shipping is going to be? Because it is complicated.
Obviously, you know, it's based on weight. And we learned from friends of ours who didn't factor in the varying weights of stuff. If somebody orders one book and gets a set of trading cards, and we mail that, that's going to cost, you know, $350 to ship. But if somebody orders everything and it's 7 pounds, that's going to cost, you know, however much more that's going to cost. I don't handle the pricing on the shipping. My wife does that, but
even figuring this out, because it is so complicated. And also, you know, I don't know where you're located. I think in Kentucky, which is more towards the center of the
we're in Cincinnati, just across the river in Kentucky.
Fair enough. But I think the point remains the same, where you're a lot closer to the center of the U.S. than I am in Connecticut. If I ship something out to somebody in Connecticut, it's significantly cheaper than when I ship something out to somebody in Texas or if I ship somebody out to California. Now, I haven't shipped. I ship out to Utah and Wyoming all the time, apparently. Apparently, I have customers there, and which is bewildering to me because I never thought I would ever ship to Utah or Wyoming. And those people spend money on comics like they're the best customers ever.
We do, too. I don't know what something's in the water, but we mail there a lot.
Comics, and they love in Wyoming military comics, apparently. But that's neither here nor there because obviously what's in Wyoming is Cheyenne.
Right.
And Cheyenne's a big military base. And there's a lot of, active military who have careers in Cheyenne. Apparently, super cool thing. But it is complicated. And so what is that like, even just figuring that out on a Kickstarter? Because I know this is your first Kickstarter that you're running. And I know that your wife...
Actually, it's our second one.
But still fairly new. I stand corrected.
This time around, we just put a disclaimer at the bottom that shipping prices vary based on products purchased. So people know that, and it obviously what I just said prior, if you're ordering a bunch of stuff, you're going to pay more for shipping. And honestly, most people don't really care because if they want the product, they want the product. The biggest problem is the international shipping. That's what kills you. We just mailed something today to Toronto. And it was three. I mailed two packages, one to Tennessee and one to Toronto, Canada. And the one in Toronto was three times as much to send. About the same distance, north versus south, from Cincinnati, but it's international. But the person knew, they live in Canada. They know if they're going to buy anything from the States, they're going to pay three times the amount of shipping. But again, if people that are into comics, that are into supporting indie creators, whether it's comics or crafting or whatever, they don't really care about the shipping. If they want the product, and that's the way I am. If I want the product, I'm going to buy it. I don't care how much the shipping is.
Also, one of the things in my eBay business, I don't know how you feel, is that I charge $10 because I ship in a Gemini.
Yeah.
And so my shipping is more expensive. But when I'm sending you a $100 book, that book is coming perfect.
Oh, yeah. We do, too. We use Geminis.
So you're going to pay more, and there's somebody else who their shipping is $5 on eBay. And I openly say to people, I say, look, I'm more expensive, but the question is that your book is going to come perfect. And I don't have any issues, and I get complimented on my eBay rating. And I'm the same way where I'll pay more money. Somebody says, I'm shipping in a Gemini, it's $3 more. I got no problem. Because if I'm already spending that much money on something, I want it to arrive perfect. Because I've had comics that come in just an envelope with no cardboard on.
Oh, yeah. We've had some of those.
some of them come perfectly and it's fine. Others don't. And I'm not too happy about it. And it's not a good thing when that happens. And so my books are up perfectly. And I think that's also the other thing as well, where I've heard horror stories about people receiving Kickstarters in no cardboard, just bent like that, almost like a pizza, like the thing, and it's just a problem. And I think that, that's the other side of this too, where if I'm buying a $20 book from your Kickstarter, and I want that thing to arrive as perfectly as possible.
Yeah.
I want it to arrive clean, and I want it to arrive neat, and I want it to arrive safely. And I think it is important in a lot of ways for that, and sometimes that costs more money.
Yeah, and we not only do we put them in Geminis, but we usually wrap them in bubble wrap, and sometimes we put backing boards or like the back of a pad of Bristol board. There's that brown cardboard that's really thick.
I mean, I double bag and board my books.
Yeah.
So what I do is that I bag and board it, and then I put another one on it, a sleeve, and then I put another two boards in there. So now, and then I wrap it in bubble wrap. And then I ship in a Gemini, and that book arrives. And then I put two extra books that are already beat up for extra cushion on top of it.
Especially when
you're spending good money. And I buy certain books for like 50 cents on the dollar. And so like you just go to a comic shop, and they have a 50 cents per bin. You buy the entire bin, and you don't care what's in the bin. And that's how you protect your books. And it's brilliant because it's all of that cushion plus the bubble wrap. It's the best way how to ship, and it makes your customer happy.
Yes, it does. We all like happy customers.
I love when my customers are happy because they buy from me again. So obviously, I don't know. Is that the cat?
No. I was paranoid about my cup sitting on the edge, so I pushed it back.
Oh no. If your cat was coming in, I would tell your cat to make an introduction.
Oh, he might be back there. There's three of them.
It's a horrific joke.
There's Sherman's laying right over there. He's kind of looking at me like, what?
But even going further into this, because I know you're going to a con next week. And so I don't know if you've been to a con yet this year.
Yeah, we have.
I'm curious because I am taking the year off. I took all last year off. I had a bad experience in 2019 in my last con. And I need some time off from it. And honestly, COVID's been a blessing because it's been a nice break from it. And I'm just taking some time off. I'm probably going to hit it back up in 2022, both as a fan and as a panelist and possibly even as a vendor. But what has that been like con-wise for you? Because I think you said you've been to one so far this year.
We've actually been to two.
So what has it been like? I'm curious.
It's been the... people are starving for independent books. We did one in Huntington, West Virginia, first weekend in June. And people practiced social distancing. People had masks on. It was fine. You know, it was just like getting right back up on the horse. I wasn't really worried about anything. It was just business as usual. And then we did a Anime Ohio here a couple of weeks ago here in Cincinnati, and that was a phenomenal show. And everybody's just – you can tell everybody's really excited about getting out and engaging with people face-to-face and having that one-on-one extended conversations. That's the one thing that I noticed is the extended conversations. People were starving for interaction. They're starving for creator-owned stuff. Something from somebody other than the big two, which we have plenty of. So it was great for us. But it's really very little difference than before the COVID. People are nicer, it seemed, more considerate, more conscious of their distance, their behavior, more cordial. And then more engaging, which I thought was kind of interesting because a lot of people will just walk past before the pandemic, they would walk past your table and kind of kick the tires and not really engage, not really kind of avoid eye contact. Now it's everybody's coming up to you and, is it okay to pick this up, and whereas before,
that there's been a bit of a shift because I guess I'll elaborate on the question a little bit because I've noticed in my view that obviously a lot more people are interested in indie right now and a lot more people are saying, hey, I'm sick of, Marvel and DC. And I it's not that they're bad and they're producing good work. That's not the issue anymore.
Right.
It's just that I think people want different and I think people are looking outside the box a little bit, not to mention that, also, people have been trapped in their houses for 70 weeks.
Yeah,
and for a long time.
And I think that's one of the biggest things is, the country and the world has just been through hell for the past 18 months, and everybody has their own experience of what that hell was, something different to each person. So they know the season.
I'm being an asshole to somebody. And
What's that?
I think because. So I'll be very, very honest. I have found that the indie comic community, 99% of it has been very good in the last 12 months. Yeah. Every once in a while, I run into an asshole in this, and we're not going to go too much into it. But, what I'm finding is that is slowly getting eradicated, I feel.
Yeah.
It will always exist, but I have a feeling even at cons moving forward, at least for the next few years, I think people are a lot more grateful, and I think they're starting to understand that this is a privilege and not a right. And yeah. I think that, I'm looking forward to coming back to panels because I think people are going to really appreciate, and I don't know how that's going to work and how that's going to go, but But I think people are going to really appreciate somebody getting up and actually speaking, and that people are going to say, you know, this is not a right anymore. And that I think that for the last 15 years, you know, really starting in 2005 all the way to about 2019, 2020, people didn't view this as a privilege. And I think now people are in a lot more ways saying, I don't have the right to be here. Me being here, me interacting with fans and creators and just talking is a privilege. It's not anything but that.
So, yeah, I think people, you know, people in general, people will take things for granted until it's taken away from them. And then the smart ones, you know, after things go back to normal, they have a level of gratitude for the situation and the what they've been through. And I think that's why the indie market really appeals to people, because, you know, people are starving for, does this tell something that I can relate to? They know what they're going to get with the Marvel and DC stuff. It's superhero stuff. DC's going to be dark and dreary. Marvel stuff's going to be funny and light and optimistic. But people are looking for other things. They want to find something that they can connect to on an emotional level that's going to talk about things that they went through, you know, over the past 18 months. And I think people are just starving for intellectual stimulation.
I think that's big too. And I think a lot of people also are now starving for what is next, and what is also, you know, I think people want to, you know, explore other concepts that can't be explored with Batman or Iron Man. And I think that's the other thing too. And I also think that, you know, people, you know, are want to spend their money that they may or may not have saved. And so I'm actually very curious about this. And you might not know the answer, but obviously, where do you foresee all this going? Because it's safe to say in the last 18 months, a lot of people have not spent a lot of money, and a lot of that money has funneled into entertainment and funneled into comics. And now with everything reopening up again, it's going to be very interesting where that's going. So where do you see that going economically? Because when the bars are open and the movies are open, and now, because before the movies were shut down, the bars were shut down, the restaurants were shut down, and a lot more money was going into comics in my world at least, and I saw it, and that's why all these comic books that like X-Men 171 was spiking, and it's still spiking because a lot more people had money to spend because they weren't necessarily making more money, but they had more money, I guess, at their disposable because it was going to other exits, for lack of a better word.
I think there's going to be an ebb and a flow. I think there's going to be an initial spike for the first probably 6 to 8 months. And I think people are going to, the smart people are going to hold on to the money that they've accumulated and invest it. And I don't mean to say smart as derogatory to anybody else, but I think
there's another good word to use. People who sort of spot the trend.
Yeah. Yeah.
In my world, I like to use trends. I like to use the idea. So I'm a comic book investor. So I know when a book is super hot and it's overpriced and I sell it.
Right.
And people are buying it. And I'm not going to, you know, it's not my job to tell somebody what is good or bad or what they want to buy or whatnot, because I don't really care why they're buying it. Somebody might say, hey, I want this book for my personal collection. I don't really care. And I'm happy to sell you something you want to buy. I want to sell it. So if I know a book is about to spike and then I sell it and then I know it's going to fall back down, I sort of know the market of it, and that's a trend. So I think that trend spotting is where it's going.
Oh yeah. And I think that's always the smart people keep the eye on the trends. And you have to be able to predict them and see them and utilize those to your advantage. You know, us in particular, you know, it definitely influences what we do, what kind of books we produce and stuff like that. It's just, you know what's going to spike, and you know what's going to level off. And then it's going to probably dip, and then it'll come back to normal. When normal is pre-pandemic. So I'm guessing that's all going to happen over the course of the next probably 3 to 5 years.
It's going to be very interesting because I've heard a lot of different conflicting things, and it's, I sort of know where the comic book investing stuff is going, but I don't know where the rest of that stuff is going. So it's good for me to pick up and then figure out where it's going. But you know, I think it's going to be very interesting with indie publishing, and I think indies are going to be dominating for the next like 2.5 years.
I definitely agree with that. And we've talked about that. I think there's going to be a new renaissance of independent.
I think
it's going to explode.
I think what's about to happen, and stop me if you disagree, but I think that there's never ever going to be another big three. There's the big two, and those are the big two indefinitely. But I think the big two have major competition, not necessarily from Image. And Image is a fighter, and Image does great work. And Image is sort of corporate, but sort of indie. Image is in a weird category. But I think that the biggest threat from DC and Marvel as a whole conglomerate is a lot of this indie stuff on Kickstarter and Indiegogo and even self-published indie, because I think those people, which either are imprints or small companies, can collectively take market share away from Marvel and DC.
I agree, and I've felt that way for decades.
I think it's becoming more evident now, where obviously I'm a lot newer to this sector. I'm about 5 years into indie. So obviously I think that in the last 18 to 2 years, they have now started to become a real contender. And definitely. I'm not saying they're going to completely put DC or Marvel out of business. That's not what I'm saying.
No, but they're going to take a bigger piece of the pie.
I think it's very easy that they can take, you know, anywhere from 5 to 10% very easily over the next 10 years.
Yeah. And if you think about it, most the last 18 months where we were locked up in our houses and all the movies and stuff that we watched on Netflix and whatever else you watched it on, a large majority of those were based on comic books, were independent comic books, whether they saw print through Dark Horse or Boom Studios or any of the smaller Mirage or any of that stuff. It's all independent stuff that's being adapted into movies. And that, you know, every time we go to see a movie, the people, regular people say, "Is that another comic book movie?" And I'll say, "Well, what do you mean?" And they say, "Well, is it based off of a comic book?" And I'll be like, "Well, yes, this one is," you know, because so, that's the thing now. So many things in Hollywood come from comics.
They're pulling out of their bullpen. So many things get optioned now.
Yeah.
And just because something gets optioned doesn't mean that it's going to be good. Doesn't mean it's going to be bad. Doesn't mean we're going to be talking about it for the next 20 years.
Right.
But there's a lot of stuff that is super, super interesting that Netflix has. But it's complicated because some of this stuff is really good. Some of it is not so good. But, you know, everything is in between. And who knows what we're going to be talking about in 20 years. And obviously the entire comic market's going crazy with a bunch of this stuff as well. And obviously we're all just waiting.
And the funny thing about that is we don't decide that. You or I, the public decides what the next Walking Dead's going to be. You know, I have no, when I sit down to write Pitter Patter, I don't think, what if this is the next, I become the next Robert Kirkman. I don't think about that. And I'm sure Robert didn't think about it when he created The Walking Dead. We don't decide that. We just do. The public makes the choice as to what's going to blow up and what doesn't. And we have no control over it.
It's very interesting in which that, you know, comic fans don't have a lot of control over their products that they spotted first. And it's super interesting, yet they become very wealthy when the public is championing those ideas, such as, you know, if you have a Walking Dead and a 9.9 or a perfect 10, and I think there's a few of those out there, you know, obviously you're sitting on a very small fortune with very minimal work.
Right. So
super interesting in that regard on how that goes. And then also, if you've read the comic, now you're cool. apparently, with The Walking Dead, because you're like, oh yeah, I read it and I have a first copy of this book, and it's kind of like owning Charizard when you were in high school or elementary school and going in the yard. So you had a Charizard card. So that's all I'm going to say on that point. I didn't have one. It's okay. I'm perfectly fine with not having one. And I was probably better off. Nobody in my school had a Charizard. And it's all right. It's all right. It's not fine. But I
you all got through it just fine.
I did have a red Gyarados. And that card was sold in my position for a good amount of money. So I got no complaints. But I digress. So obviously, we covered a lot of stuff. And I do want to give you an opportunity to promote yourself. So obviously, where can the Kickstarter be found? Obviously, people should back the Kickstarter. I don't think I need to say that. Where can people follow you on social media? Where can people follow Pitter Patter on social media? And obviously, you know, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook pages, website, anything of that nature.
So I have Hazm has a website. It's hazm.com, hazzum.com. And you can go there. You can get the books, everything that we've printed up to date available. You can purchase the books there. We just put up a new gallery of some of my stuff that I've done over the last 10 years this past weekend. So that's new. There's a blog up there with a couple of installments, and I go back to the 90s and talk about my adventures in the 90s. I'm on Facebook, just Rodney Fyke. And then I also have The Art of Rodney Fyke on Facebook. I'm on Instagram at Rodney_Fyke on Instagram. Twitch, Rodney Fyke at Twitch. Do a Thursday night throwdown or a Friday night draw podcasts with Sean Forney, my buddy Sean Forney, where we do a 30-minute sketch-off. Those are Thursdays and Friday nights, 8 o'clock Eastern, on our Hazm YouTube channel. And you can watch those at The Art of Rodney Fyke or at the Sean Forney Art. We go back and forth. On Thursday, it's on all of my social platforms. And on Friday, it's on all of Sean Forney's social platforms. So we do that Thursday and Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern time. And I stream in the mornings at 11 o'clock. I usually draw for about 30 minutes or so. And it's usually me just working on a commission or something like that. So I'm all over the place.
And obviously, you know, I've been saying this, and I'm going to keep saying this, is that you have to support indie. And what that means is that you have to back people's Kickstarters. Yes. A lot of these projects cannot be made without Kickstarter. But even going further, you know, obviously you need to share the Kickstarter. You need to check out people's websites. Look, if the Kickstarter doesn't fit your forte, you need to share the Kickstarter. It can be very helpful because you don't know who's watching. Every share matters. Every like matters. Also, you know, checking out people's website, because they might be working, and obviously you work on a horror comic, and somebody might love horror comics and they might not love Pitter Patter. But right. They'll go out and buy your horror book, right. And that's supporting an artist, and that helps, you know, you, and it indirectly helps the Kickstarter, because obviously every time somebody buys your work or buys a book, it obviously sort of helps to further your career. So it is super important to go do that. If something doesn't fit your genre that you love, you know, a lot of writers and artists work on a lot of books, and a lot of them have something that will fit it. And even if it doesn't, and you really like it, obviously you should back it. And obviously sharing is super important. Following on social media platforms, and as well as, you know, anybody who's doing anything indie, you know, best thing you can do for anybody indie is share their content around more so than anything else, because it goes a long way. You never know who's watching, and you never know that the saying is that somebody's problem is your solution. Well, you know, that's an amazing way to look at this. And if you share something, there you go. You might be providing somebody a solution to something, or they might be like, oh man, I love cats. How did I not know this was around? And that's happened on this show where I was interviewing somebody, and that person got legitimately 5 backers, and they actually put up their backer numbers in it. And then the person checked, and it turns out that it was perfectly matched. So one person sharing. So on that note, I'm going to give you the final word.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to say thank you for having me on. I greatly appreciate it. And I ask that everybody go to the Kickstarter, Pitter Patter Kickstarter, and check it out.
It's up above.
It's up above. Yeah, there we go. And if it's not your cup of tea, that's fine. But we ask that you share it out to your friends and family. But also know that you're getting issues 1 and 2. And then you're also getting a whole bag of goodies to go with it, which if you went to the store and you bought them, you're just going to get the books. If you buy them here, you're going to get the trading cards. You're going to get the stickers, the enamel pin, all that fun stuff comes with it. So why not buy it during the Kickstarter? I thank you all for your time tonight. I appreciate the platform to be able to talk about what I do. So thank you again, Andrew, for having me on, and I greatly appreciate it.
Well, thank you for being on, and I appreciate you showing up because it is important to talk about these topics.
Yes, I agree.
And that is a wrap.